Football Fever family and football fans alike. Hey, welcome to an actual episode of Football Fever. I thank you guys for tuning in and, you know, chiming in with the shorts and everything over the past few weeks, past couple of months. Thank you for your time. This is basically going to be a real episode. This is what they'll look like going forward. I'm your host, Tony G. I'll be your host for the foreseeable future, or like I said, until somebody else kicks me off the show, which will likely be never. But thanks again to all my subscribers, all the Football Fever fans. This is a special week. We're kicking off the show. Everything's going to be pretty much like this going forward. When the season starts, we'll still do our highlights and stuff like that. But this is what our show format's going to be like. We're going to do some interviews. We're going to go over some plays and stuff like that. But yeah, man, let's kick off the season in the right way. Today, our topics are going to be about some really high-profile injuries. I know a lot of the fantasy football guys and girls out there, you know, there's some things that we kind of hang on to at the end of the season, you know, wanting to know if our favorite players are going to be back and stuff like that. But today we're going to talk about high-profile injuries. And specifically for the Niner fans, we've got some information for you. You know, I'm a former football player for high school, nothing after that. And I never knew the science or anything behind injuries. I was just told to ice up, get back on the field, right? So I come to you today with some information, but it won't come from me. The cool thing is I know a guy, and I went and got a professional, and not just any professional. I have a friend near and dear to my heart, but I'd like to give you this person's accolades so that you know that all the information you receive today is the correct information. This individual is a physical therapist, certified athletic trainer, and a certified strength and conditioning specialist with education from Desales, Doctor of Physical Therapy, East Stroudsburg, Master of Athletic Training, and Bachelor's in Exercise Science from East Stroudsburg. So with no further ado, I'd like to introduce my friend, Dr. Brian Veras. Brian, welcome to the show.
Hey, Tony, what's going on, my man? I appreciate you for letting me on the show. And nice to meet you all, Football Fever community. Let's have a good one. Tony's got his silver and black on today, so he's supporting the Raiders just for tonight. And we'll see if we can convert them.
Yeah, I actually forgot to mention, too. Doctor here is an avid Raiders fan. Shout out to Raider Nation. You guys don't have anything. We're not going to be talking about anything good about you guys today, but that's a good thing because it's injury related. But as the season progresses, we'll have some good news because you guys have made some interesting moves. But shout out to Raider Nation. Thanks again, Brian Veras. And Brian, you know, I'm reading your accolades on paper. I'd like for you to just give you know, give the fans a little bit about yourself, a quick bio, you know, just so they know who you are, what you do. Because coming from me, again, I'm a football guy. Your world, I'd like you to explain that to the fans.
Yeah, no, so essentially for me getting to where I am at, I was also a former high school football player. We won states in Jersey my sophomore year. Hey. With that, yeah, the Wolfpack right there. And yeah, and that always sparked my interest in sports medicine and working in the world that I'm in now right now. So I've done all this stuff, all this schooling to refine my skills in different aspects of sports medicine, whether it's just acute injury on the middle of the field, rehabbing these athletes with that, and then strength conditioning to get a bigger, faster, stronger, essentially, with that too. So I hope to share my knowledge with you guys. And me and Tony are going to have some fun with this episode.
Absolutely, man. Thanks again. Yeah, so I went and got a professional, guys. It's as good as it gets. We could debate, all of us regular fans could debate about injuries and timelines all we want, but here we have it. Real professional. So I want to dive into this, and this one's going to be a big one. It's going to hurt a lot of people. Some people are not going to care about it, but I think we should jump into what I think might be one of the higher profile injuries stemming from last season. I wanted to talk about Brock Purdy. Now, for all the Niners fans out there, don't get upset what you hear today. It may be good news. It may be not so good news. We don't know. But here's a guy who had an interesting story, right, Doc? He, like, you know, third string. You know, he was drafted, but he wasn't supposed to be the guy, right? They drafted another guy. He was on the bench. Things got a little weird. But quarterback started going down. Boom, insert Brock Purdy. Guy, I don't even think he lost the game, right, on his way to the playoffs. I forget what the record was, but he kind of, you know, tore things up toward the end of the season, had a nice playoff run. And then, in a game with, you know, against the Eagles, he had this really bad, elbow injury that a lot of us didn't understand, Doc. To be honest with you, I had no idea what was going on with Brock Purdy. I'm like, why can't he throw? It was very, very confusing. He was like a decoy. So before we jump in, I mean, like, it's your turn, but I got to ask, Doc, how bad is Brock Purdy's injury? And I will let you expand beyond that.
Yeah, so there's a lot of angles to take this from. So for Brock Purdy's injury, he actually had a ruptured ulnar collateral ligament with that. And so for any strains and sprains, you have a grading scale 1, 2, and 3, essentially. First one is just going to be strong and painful, essentially, and try to simplify this. Your second grade is going to be weak and painful. And then your third one is going to be weak and pain-free, because it's actually just going to be completely torn. And unfortunately, that's what Brock Purdy had against that game against the Eagles. So going a little bit more into it.
So Brock Purdy's was completely torn.
Yes.
Okay.
Yikes. Yeah. And what he tore was, we call it a UCL or ulnar collateral ligament.
Okay.
And essentially what that is on the inside of your elbow here, it's a ligament that provides most of the stability as the prime stabilizer for the inside of the elbow.
Right.
So if you can imagine, if you're throwing a football, throwing a baseball with that, you're throwing, and when you're cocking back and then switching back into the acceleration phase, you're putting a ton of stress on that going forward. So you just get a lot of gapping and strain on that ligament with that. A lot of the research is primarily done in baseball because you see this in pitchers. Okay. With that, many of us have probably heard of Tommy John surgery, and yes, that is going to be the surgical procedure that they do to repair the UCL. But with that, one really interesting fact that I want to share with you guys. So in that throwing phase that I was talking about, when you're cocking back and changing to the early acceleration phase, for a normal throw, it normally puts around 64 Newton meters, what we call just whatever measurement of force on that area.
Okay.
But for the UCL, it specifically takes 32 Newton meters of force to rupture. So if you can imagine, for every throw that you're doing, you're applying 2 times of the force that the elbow can handle, essentially. What? And essentially how the body reacts to that is that it uses everything from the hands to the shoulder blades, even your trunk, to rotate to control and absorb the rest of that force.
Wow.
So just putting it into perspective with that, yeah, like, we don't give enough appreciation for what throwing athletes do. And especially for Brock Purdy, he has that football and baseball background as well, too. You know, and that's part of the reason what makes him so great and so special. But on the other end of that, that might have been one of the things that may have set him up for where he's at today.
Wow. Unbelievable. So I just want to take a step back, right? So basically, every throw attempt that a quarterback takes is a chance to rupture this ligament?
In theory, yes.
Okay. Wow. So before I get into the timeline, right? All right. This thing happens. Let's take it down to the field too, right? So now that we know what happened scientifically, like, was it even safe for him to even be in the game after that? Because he did take a few snaps as like a decoy. What were your thoughts on that?
Yeah. So, personally, these guys, they know their bodies, like, as far as the, even though we're medical professionals,
yep,
these guys have the best sense of their bodies, you know? So, like, you got to listen to what they're saying. These guys have so much money on the line. They're playing their whole heart and their whole season out with that. So you take some of that into consideration as well, too. But as far as him being on the field, it's so variable because everyone presents differently. You know what I mean? They
right.
don't necessarily do the imaging right away, especially for MRI. Right. To diagnose a UCL injury, they normally just do their x-rays right. In the locker rooms if they need to. So it wouldn't have even picked this up with that too.
Wow.
But then if you want to compare it to what's the Bills quarterback's name? Josh Allen. So he had the same exact injury.
That's right.
But yep. it was a different grade. So he didn't lose the function of his throw. So essentially with the ruptured UCL, you lose a lot of control when you're coming forward and down
okay.
with that. That's the biggest complaint that a lot of people have, that loss of control. And right, then right. it all depends. Everyone's different, you know what I mean? So for Allen, he didn't necessarily have that. So he was confident. He played a few weeks and tried to ride it out without that. But for Brock Purdy, that wasn't necessarily the case. You know what I mean? So the presentation of everyone is different.
Gotcha. Okay, so there. Okay, so there's the difference between Josh Allen, because Josh Allen, he stuck out. You know, he was out there slinging. I felt bad because I'm like, what's going on with Brock? Now I get it. Okay.
Yeah, so, and like I would assume that Josh Allen didn't have as severe of a UCL tear or sprain as Brock Purdy, but it's just some food for thought. You know what I mean? You got to look at each individual case individually.
Gotcha. All right. So let's look at some positive or negative news for Niners fans. So I'm sure everybody wants to know this. And I mean, if, depending on where your spot is in your fantasy draft, you might want to know this as well, right? Realistically, I mean, what's rehab like for this level of severity for that injury? What's rehab like, and how's he going to come back if he can come back, you know, during but before the start of the season? What's that look like? Take us through that timeline.
Yeah, so I'll actually start us off with a little history lesson and kind of start us off with how the surgery developed with that too. So we were talking about how a lot of the research comes from baseball. And with that, there was a Dodgers player. His name was Tommy John. Mm-hmm. And he was the first one to get this procedure. And it was successful. He was on the LA Dodgers at the time. So he was the surgery was performed by the surgeon for the Dodgers with that too. And with that, and it just was a game changer for these injuries, because like before the surgery, if you had it, like your career was essentially shot, you know, and that's not necessarily the case anymore. Like you can see a lot of things in baseball that like a lot of these guys, they report that they throw harder and faster with that, which is very interesting, you know, and it doesn't necessarily rely over in football with that too. But like once you get to a comfortable point with it, like the outcomes are usually pretty good. It's just lengthy, because like one thing that we often neglect is just for surgery. That's trauma on top of trauma.
Right.
With that too. And like people take that for granted. You know what I mean? But like as far as like his timeline of everything, like usually like for the rehab process, you'll have like essentially your three phases broken down. The first one is going to be just to get the inflammation down and get the elbow moving again before you really worry about more brain pain down, some of those things. And then with Brock Purdy specifically, his surgery was even delayed because he had a lot of inflammation with that. So I don't think he went into surgery until till March with that too.
Oh, wow.
So
that's that's right. Okay.
Yeah. So that slowed down his process a little bit. And then with that, like with surgery, you're looking to like at least 9 months, 6 to 9 months before like you get back into throwing things like that and like feeling good about it. And then there's some other stuff that says that most athletes feel good between anywhere 10 to 18 months with that too. So that's a wider range, that 10 to 18 months.
Okay.
Between a year and a half with that. So it's all going to be specific to him and a lot of the other factors that go into rehab with that too.
All right, so I want to we can kind of give you hope and some despair here, right? So you're saying a couple things. So Brock Purdy, he gets surgery. There's a chance that, you know, so 6 to 9 months right before throwing. Did you say 6 to 9 months?
So like that he like would be good to like be back on the field. He'll probably start that throwing progression between like anywhere between weeks 14 to 26 usually. Okay. And that's when you get the arm pretty much from hand to shoulder strong enough that it can start supporting getting back into that. So most of the healing for the tissue is actually pretty set at that point. But with that, like throwing's a whole different ball game as well too. And then as far as being comfortable with the throwing, doing other things you got to do in your sport, that's its own process on top of it as well.
Gotcha. And one thing that you said this that kind of jumped out at me is that you're saying that after this surgery, there's the potential that there's a potential of Brock Purdy even coming back, throwing the ball harder and faster.
Yeah. So again, like most of the research is from baseball with that, and they're going to have a lot more like pitch counts or throwing counts as you can imagine. But just one thing I pulled up, which is super interesting, that for MLB, so 83% of pitchers return to their prior level of function, as we like to call it, so they get back to their square one. And what they see in MLB pitchers is they, after the surgery and the rehab, they throw fewer innings, fewer complete games, and fewer wins per season. But on the other end of that, they usually have less walks and hits per inning pitch or whip. With that, fewer home runs per games, fewer walks given up, and a lower earned ERA after having the surgery and once they're all feeling good. You know, and then with baseball, considering that, just a sport, you're throwing a lot more as a pitcher, and the volume is a lot more than that you'd have on in a football quarterback, you know, when you're throwing at most 40 times a game. And that's like if you're throwing a ton, like if you're Herbert or Mahomes or something like that, you know, versus a baseball player who's going to throw it 70, 80 pitches sometimes, you know?
Gotcha. All right, so look, there's some hope. So, all right, Doc, before we leave Brock Purdy, right? So Niners fans, right? Niners fans, this is for you. When it comes to Brock Purdy, Doc, can fans, can they breathe a sigh of relief, or should they be holding their breath and crossing their fingers? Go.
So that's a tough question because the whole Niners quarterback situation took quite a turn the past few years. So even regardless of how Brock Purdy does, you know, like he's got some of the best medical staffs in the world working for him.
Right.
He's going to have some question marks just outside of that. How Trey Lance develops XYZ, you know what I mean? But as far as him coming back, just definitely long-term, he can definitely come back and be strong, healthy, do all the things he needs to with that too. You know, and like most of that would tend towards that it would. So just with UCL athletes, and this is more college and adolescent athletes, 97% of them return to their sport.
Right.
And you have a relatively lower failure rate, or like a re-tear essentially of like 6 to 7% with that. So for Niners fans, the odds are in their favor that he can come back from this.
You heard it here from the doctor himself, a professional. Niners fans, you could just hold tight, man. Things might work in your favor. We appreciate that, Doc. Thank you for the information.
Always.
All right. I want to jump into a couple other ones. These won't be as much as in depth, but we need your expertise. So I don't know about anybody else out there. I'm a big Michael Thomas fan, and Michael Thomas, the wide receiver, all-star stud, you know, for the New Orleans Saints. Been a while since we've seen him finish a season, right? There's been a lot of it's been ankle sprain, hamstring, ankle sprain. It's been a few years since his amazing season. But like, talk to us about like what's going on with Michael Thomas. What do we expect to see from him this year, Doc, or not see from him? What do you think? Like give us your insight on like what's been going on with him in terms of his career, and you know, if we can see him play.
Yeah, no, and essentially like this was such an interesting case for everything too, just because like considering the talent history that he's had. So I actually was looking up all of his past injuries before I even started going into the new surgery that he recently had. And with that, everything from March 15th, 2015, all the way to 2022, he's had 7-8 injuries, and they've all been on the same leg, that right leg, with that, every single one of them.
Wow.
With that. And I thought that was super interesting. Like he had like athletic pubalgia or sports hernia, as what they used to call it. Some foot sprains, some high ankle sprains. Those are always nasty to rehab. Hamstring strains, those are super common. Those normally reoccur too, that we know. And then things get a little crazy with the toe dislocation. So that's was his biggest problem last year. He dislocated his toe. And that can be very variable in itself. And he tried to give it a go, prep for the season with it, and ultimately had surgery to repair that.
Wow. It's one of those things where like we don't know, right? Like I'm a fan. I mean, you're a fan too, right? But you're more educated when it comes to that stuff. I want to see the guy play, man. He was a baller, and like those injuries always, like when they start piling up, like as a non-medical guy, it's easy for me to kind of forget, like, all right, he goes in, he leaves. You know what I mean? But it's always good to hear, you know, how complicated it can be. If you have any words for the Saints fans, because for me personally, Saints fans, I don't know. I think you should hold your breath on this one. I miss him just like you miss him. I'm not a Saints fan. I can get into that later, but I love Michael Thomas. Want to see him out there. But Doc, what's your take on Saints fans and how they should feel about seeing Michael Thomas on the field this season?
Yeah, so this is going to be very variable, honestly. So as far as dislocations, the toe dislocations are not common at all. So you have your more common joints that like your shoulder, your kneecap, your fingers. Those are very common for dislocations.
Right.
But there you have some other joints that are less common. So like the hip, ankle, elbow, and at least from my training, I was taught that these are all medical emergencies with that for the non-common ones, just because you have a lot of nerves and arteries and veins that run around those structures and they might be compromised. So Michael Thomas wasn't dealing with that. Like, usually our job is to roll out all the bad stuff first. You know what I mean? But, like, right. Just because we rolled out all the bad stuff doesn't mean there's not going to be lingering effects.
Right.
Almost with that, too. With dislocations, with a dislocation, essentially the joint goes out of place and it doesn't reset naturally with that, too. So the joint and the stability of that joint are always going to be compromised after that. So man, that's necessarily going to change, you know, and just me thinking out loud, that's probably why they went with the surgical route. They're probably having trouble with that. It was probably subluxing a lot going in and out at that point. And for a joint, you want that stability. So that would probably be my biggest indication of why they went surgery, not even necessarily pain. And then as far as the whole conversation to reset or not reset a joint with that too. So ideally, in theory, you want to reset it as soon as possible. Right. Like, you got to rule out fractures, all that neurovascular stuff, rule out all the contraindications if they have to get referred out. But essentially, you want to get that back into place as soon as possible, because you're just adding more and more damage to the joint with that, too. I don't remember the specific player, the game that it happened with Michael Thomas, but he might have just played the whole game with it, too, and was like, oh, I'll worry about the locker room. You know what I mean?
Man.
But with that too, but the longer the joint is out for, the worse the outcomes essentially are going to be with that. And man, I was looking at a lot of research. Most of it's for the hands. There's really not on the toes, but it's the same like anatomical orientation with that too. So depending on which direction the dislocation is, it can either be less stable or a lot less stable. So there's different varying degrees with that too. And just for like a lower degree one, usually takes about 4 to 6 weeks to return, like even without surgery, you know, but you can have problems way out from there too. And that's going to be your swelling, your inflammation, the recurrence of the dislocations, chronic stiffness, which is also something that's very common with the prolonged, the joint being out and misplaced like that. So, man, a lot to take in there for his case.
Absolutely, man. Hey, look, to the Saints fans, I mean, and people who love Michael Thomas, I mean, it sounds like it's going to be an uphill battle. You know, this may be something reoccurring. We've seen him at his height. It'd be nice to see him there again, but we just don't know. That's why we got to, you know, we got to speak to a professional. It's a tough pill to swallow, but I wanted to get your take on that because, I mean, I love him. There's probably millions of fans who love him, but that was something I was thinking about. Hey, man, appreciate that. So I want to get your take on sports medicine now versus, you know, prior, you know, where it wasn't as advanced. But before we get into that, I want to get into one other high-profile injury that was looming. And this is an interesting one because Odell Beckham Jr. recently just got a new job. He just signed a deal with the Ravens, which is interesting because they've got some question marks at quarterback. But he was, you know, he was very adamant about, you know, working out and showing off his skills. And the guy looks good. And we know that when he's in tip-top shape and he's actually on the field, I mean, there's not a lot of guys who can cover him. I mean, I'm sure you would agree, right, Doc?
Oh, 100%. He was one of the baddest dudes in the league. Oh, he was at his top.
Agreed. Odell Beckham Jr., man, he he's a bad man. But I want to talk about his injury history. I haven't seen him, you know, haven't seen him really ball since the Super Bowl. And then, you know, he was struggling, you know, trying to find a contract. Teams didn't want to take a chance. He just signed a contract. But let's talk about what was happening with him. He had an ACL tear, and on the face of it, that's what us fans know. Gonna take a year to come back. But he's had some history there. Could you expand? You know, just give us a little bit of insight on his injury history.
Oh yeah, definitely. So like we talked about Michael Thomas's rap sheet a bit. Just he's had so much on that leg, and Odell almost doubles that on that. I believe it was the same right leg with that too. So with that, since his career, he's had 13 injuries on that right leg. A lot of them reoccurring ones with that too, hamstrings, ACL.
Hold on, real quick, Doc. So Odell Beckham Jr. has had 13 injuries.
Just in the right leg.
Odell Beckham Jr. has had 13 injuries in his right leg.
Yes, throughout his playing career. I think it might have been going back to some of his LSU days for some of these. You know what I mean? But with that, football's a rough sport, you know?
Unbelievable. He looks good, you know, over the like early spring and late winter and stuff like that. He was looking good. He just got a deal. What are your thoughts on like him coming back and, you know, being able to play his style of ball? Cause he plays a very, low center of gravity, very, very agile style of ball. What's your take on him coming back and possibly being healthy?
Yeah. So, there's a lot of factors to take into this. So as far as for him with, he tore his ACL as a grade 3, in the Super Bowl, like we talked about, and that was at the end of two seasons ago. So it's been some time now. But one of the things that we know just from research is that the biggest predisposer of any injury is a previous history of the same injury. And this is Odell Beckham's second ACL tear on that same one. So considering all that, we like to look at these things in isolation. And part of the I guess the reason why there's not necessarily a straight answer is because like, even like with research and like our fields, we don't have a perfect answer for like what surgery is the best, what rehab is the best, you know, like we kind of throw out that number for 9 to 12 months as that timeline to return. But there is some stuff out there too, that some of these athletes that they're not ready until 2 years later. And a lot of that is just because the proprioceptive or just the positioning of the joint that really predisposes further injury, because that takes a little while to get back for some of these athletes. And it could be up to 2 years. So even though like we can test everything good in the rehab clinic or the weight room, he's cutting on the field like nothing's changed.
Right.
We don't know if we're using the right metrics essentially and doing the best jobs to make sure that we're letting them loose at the right time.
Wow. Wow, man. It could take up to 2 years ACL. Some interesting info, Doc. I appreciate that. We wish the best for OBJ. I like to watch him play. Again, I get down the road when we get more into the episodes, I could talk about some of the moments where he kind of like ruined television for me. But yeah, man, we hope to see him play. You know, to all the fantasy fans out there, hey, look, man, take a chance on him. Yeah, he's got a new deal. They paid him a pretty decent amount of money, but he was one of those injuries where it's like, man, like, do we see him again at his best, or like, is this gonna kind of be like, is he gonna kind of be on and off the field for the, you know, for the remainder of his career? So, always appreciate your insight, Doc, and wanted to basically get, you know, for the fans out there, let you know, when injuries happen and we kind of we're like, you know, we look at the next player, stuff like that. What's your take on sports medicine, how it's evolved, you know, now versus then, your own experiences and your education? Kind of just give us some information about sports medicine and how you think it's come along.
Oh, 100%. There's so many ways to approach this question. Just the knowledge of, like, the need of sports science has definitely evolved. Over the past 10, 15 years, we're really seeing that a lot of teams are investing more in the number of their staff, who they have, even coming out to like sports nutritionists, sports psychologists, on top of the doctors, athletic trainers, like some of these professions that you always see, that you really have some pretty pretty dense medical staffs with that. So for me, I was even looking at a staff to be a part of. And for them, they had, I believe it was 11 or 12 rehab professionals for a 53-man roster. You know what I mean? So as far as that, like, a lot of teams really see the benefit and health with that.
Right.
To help out their athletes too. But like with that too, the outcomes necessarily haven't been that much different with that too. So there's a little disconnect with that, and no one knows where it's really from. With okay. that, it's very individualized with that too.
Right.
Depending on the teams, kind of what they have over there, where some of those deficits are coming from with that too. And it's kind of just across sports. A lot of it is even just like with athletes starting so young and the pressure off these guys, AAU, with that too. A lot of the like overuse injuries, like their bodies are almost essentially beat up by the time right. they even get to the NFL.
Wow. I always thought about that.
Yeah.
Like the beating that they take before they get there. Cause we start like, it's weird. Cause we start counting their miles once they become professional football players. I'm like, man, we should probably start counting the miles like 3 or 4 years prior to that. You know what I mean?
Oh, 100%. And like, as we know, just in general for like humans, not necessarily athletes, like the body starts to slowly decline at age 25 with that too. And that's essentially when most of these guys are getting into the league. They're still on their first rookie year deal with that too. So like, that's when they're like physically in theory at their strongest. You know what I mean?
Gotcha. Gotcha. We have to consider that, guys. We got to think about it. Like, these guys, when they get into the NFL, they've already got some heavy mileage on them. So we do have to give them a break. And again, not for me, from a professional. Doc, man, I can't thank you. I can't thank you more for being on the show. Honestly, your insight means a lot. I look forward to going through the season, getting your insight. And Raider Nation, tap in with this young man. Quit playing around. This is a guy who knows his stuff. Stamped, sealed. Raider Nation, Dr. Brian Veras. I can't thank you enough, man. You've been good to me professionally and personally. Your insight means everything. As the season go on, man, do you mind if we call you from time to time?
Oh, 100. You know, I'll be back. And I got to keep tab on my Raiders, too, with that.
Yes,
because we're going to have some hot takes coming out for them.
Yes, for sure. Oh, man, Raider Nation, y'all got some interesting stuff, man. Y'all got one of my favorite players. I'm a big Jimmy G fan. Again, I'll get into that later. I would love to chime in, you know, about the Raiders with you. A lot of fun stuff. Vegas is one of my, you know, favorite places on the planet, too. So, definitely. So, you guys heard it from Dr. Brian Vera today. Hey, Doc, is there anything you want to leave with us? I mean, we know you're professional. You know you're busy. Is there like a Twitter account where anybody can follow you? You know, any other Raiders fans that might be watching?
I'm actually not that big of a social media guy. I have Twitter, so I'm actually BVer74 on there. Gotcha. I'm more of a kind of follow content type guy.
Yep.
But with that too, I'm also in LinkedIn as well too, Brian Veras, as well with that too.
Awesome. So look, I mean, obviously he's a busy guy. So the good thing about him not being on social media is he's actually like doing his job and, you know, giving us the information. So we got to be thankful for that. So we appreciate that, man. Look, man, time is valuable. You know, you're definitely a friend of the show. You've been a blessing. It's the first week of us filming the actual show, man. And thank you. Since I started talking about this thing, man, you were with me the whole time. So I appreciate that, guys. Raider Nation, tap in. Football Fever, tap in. Thank you, guys. I'm your host, Tony G, and this is Football Fever. We'll see you next time.